checking my vital signs, drawing my battle lines, going to war again. Feeling the rhythm inside of my chest, all I need is just a pen. I know I was born for this. I know I was born for this. Don't care for the critics, my words and life physics are force that they can't stop. They just don't get it, I think they forget I'm not done till I'm on top. I know I was born for this. I know I was born for this. But have the same name. Cause we were born for this. We were born for this. We are the broken ones who chose to spark a flame. Watch as our fire rages. Our hearts are never. Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to the sixth broadcast coming to you live from the Bamboo Lab. Happy Valentine's Day, everyone. I hope all of you have someone out there you can share this beautiful day with. If you do, have a partner, a wife, a husband, boyfriend, girlfriend, whatever it might be, do everything you can today to show them how much you love them, understand them, respect and appreciate them. Those are the foundations of all human needs. Everything you do, everything I do, everything anybody has ever done in the course of history has been designed. We've done those things to gain one or more of those. We want to be loved, man. We want to be understood and respected and appreciated. And if you can share that and show someone to that, someone those four emotions and those four values on a consistent basis, wow, it's good stuff, man. And if you have somebody who does that for you, you are a blessed human being. Not just on the 14th of February every year, but 365 days a year. What are you afraid of? I'm asking you, strivers, thrivers, and survivors out there who this podcast is made for. I want to find out what you're afraid of. What are the things that cause you the most pain in this world? This podcast is for you. I wrote it for you. I'm saying these words for you. Maybe you feel you're stuck a little bit on the hamster wheel of life, spinning, 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 not going too far. Maybe you feel like you're a little bit of an underachiever. It's like, damn, I got a lot more to offer this world. Where is that extra oomph I need? Well, here it is. We're going to start that process and continue that process today. We've had some great feedback and some great downloads and comments from a lot of our viewers. And I thank all of you for being tuned in tonight and for the tuning in that you've been doing over the past few couple of months. So back to the question, what are you afraid of? Randy Pausch, a gentleman I never met. I've only seen him speak and I've only read his written words. He's become a hero of mine, someone I have followed and worshipped to some degree over the past, 15 years or so. Randy Pausch for those of you who don't know, was a Carnegie Mellon University computer science professor. In September of 2006, he was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. He was told by his doctors, you're not going to pull through this. This is the end of your journey here on Earth. You know, think about what that would do to the average human. The strife, the worry, the fear, the despair, the disappointment, the anger that would cause. Randy had a different viewpoint on that. Randy took this opportunity as a learning for his children, his boys. See, at Carnegie Mellon University, when you retire, you are given the opportunity to give a speech in the auditorium. You can choose whoever you want to come, family, friends, coworkers, colleagues. You can choose the topic. He chose this. What are your brick walls? See, he knew that his sons were going to grow up without a father figure in their lives, or at least without him in their lives here on Earth. So he wrote these words and said these words just directly and intimately for them. What are your brick walls? In this long, hour-long speech that you can find on YouTube, or you can buy his book that he wrote after this YouTube video took off, called The Last Lecture. Google it, buy the book, you will not leave the same person who entered that hour-long speech or those written words. He talked in there, he talked to his sons about overcoming obstacles, and he had a lot to say. But the one thing that he said that resonated most with me, that I hope resonates with you out there tonight, he said to his sons, these eternal words, "The brick walls are there for a reason. The brick walls are not there to keep us out. The brick walls are there to give us a chance to show how badly we want something. Because the brick walls are there to stop the people who don't want it badly enough. They're there to stop the other people." Brick walls. I mean, call it what it is. How many of us have come across a brick wall in life, metaphorically, and turned and walked away, disgruntled, discouraged? Even though we knew deeply that beyond that brick wall or through that brick wall was what we were looking for, what we were seeking in life. Mr. Pausch fought a valiant battle, but on the date of July 25th, 2008, at the age of 47, he succumbed. He went on, continued his journey elsewhere, and left us a better planet. All because he understood the concept of smashing through and scaling the brick walls. What are yours? You know, think about we as humans. How often do you seek to avoid pain? Pain of all types, physical, emotional, intellectual. We don't want to be hurt. We want to be comforted. We want to be cocooned. Life is not about the avoidance of pain. Life is all about choosing your pain. Because pain is unavoidable. I mean, shit, our whole existence is all based on pain. And there are some pains that we want to avoid. I don't know if I said it last week. Well, I couldn't have. It hadn't happened yet, I don't think. But coming back from Park City, Utah, Kelly, my much better half, and I were in the Salt Lake City airport, and I was carrying two heavy bags of luggage up the escalator. Those escalators in airports—they're not—you know—they're not—they're not short. They're long. They extend for a while. Well, I wasn't very far up it, but I was up enough for me to experience my lower bag that was below me on the step below me get caught on the step as it was rising. And in my valiant attempt to save it, Sir Isaac Newton took over and I succumbed to gravity and fell. Now, I'll tell you, falling is one thing. Falling on an escalator, whole new level. Because when you try to get up, there's nothing to grab onto. The floor is moving. And I was in pain, man. I had to finally yell for someone to help me, and they shut the escalator down, and two gentlemen picked me up. Kelly came down, you know, panicked and frantically got to me right at that time as well. She tried to get through, you know, over people and luggage. I got up. A lot of me was hurting. My knees, my arm, my side, my back, my shin, but mostly my pride. It's pretty embarrassing falling in front of 1,000 people on an escalator. That's the kind of pain you want to avoid. But the vast majority of other pains in this world, we want to embrace. We want to control them. We want to choose them on a consistent basis. Because there really are only two types of pain. These brick walls that come into our world. And we have a choice of which one we take on. But what we don't have is a choice of whether we take one on. It's inevitable. There are two types. Pain of hard work, grit, sacrifice, blood, sweat, and tears. Or there's the pain of regret. There is no third option. You see, if you choose the pain of hard work, it's going to hurt, and it's going to hurt right now. Getting up early on these cold, February mornings to go to the gym, making those 3 extra sales calls that day, having that really difficult conversation you have to have with one of your peers or someone who reports to you at work, asking for a raise, sitting down with your partner and sharing some concerns you have about your relationship. Man, that takes a lot of guts. And when you do those things, man, you're rewarded, but you're rewarded right away with sweat, nervousness, maybe a few angry words shared, maybe a rejection, being cold in the morning as you go to the gym and feeling that pain of hitting that treadmill or lifting the weights that you lift or whatever it is you might do. But I'll tell you what, man, it beats the alternative. Because even though you're experiencing that pain right now because you made that choice of hard work and dedication, we all know that that is a very short-term pain. Because it's a growing pain. It's a pain that builds you. It grows. It strengthens you. It's a strength-based pain. But you don't have to choose it. You can ignore it. Say, no, I'm going to stay in. It's warm under my comforter this morning. I'm not going to get up and go to the gym. I'm going to stay here and hit my snooze button. I'm not going to go ask for a raise. I'm not going to confront someone who's disrespected me or is doing something wrong at work. I'm not going to go share any of my challenges I have with my partner. No way, man. Because if I don't do that right now, I get to stay safe. I get to remain in my comfort zone. And man, that comfort zone is a sweet spot. It's like eating cotton candy at the carnival. It's like chocolate ice cream, man. It's just a beautiful thing to savor at the moment. But I'll tell you what. If you don't choose that first pain and you choose the pain of or the comfort that we just discussed, life will choose the second pain for you, the pain of regret. And I'll tell you what, man, that one's not short term. That pain of regret is eternal. It sticks forever. So as we run through life trying to avoid conflict or physical, emotional, intellectual growth and pain, we're simply destroying ourselves. It's a very slow way to die. But the moment you choose the pain of regret over the pain of hard work, you begin to die. Figuratively and metaphorically. Figuratively, metaphorically, and in reality. So think right now, what are those things that you have right now in your life that you're struggling to decide, should I do this? You've been procrastinating, you've been putting off, you've been putting on the back burner for quite some time now because you just know there's a lot of discomfort coming with it. Ask yourself, do I want short-term pain or do I want eternal pain? Do I want a pain that strengthens me and builds me or do I want a pain that weakens and destroys me in the end? You know, I recall a time years and years ago, and it's not even a major event, but it stuck with me. But and the lesson is there. It was my first year as a financial advisor in Okemos, Michigan. I was with a company called IDS Financial Services. And I know some of you listeners were there probably the moment this happened. There were 29 financial advisors in my office, and I was in my first 6 months of my career. And we were ranked by production. So I'm very open with my ranking. I was number 29. I was the low person on the totem pole. I couldn't get it. I mean, I was young. I was avoiding pain quite clearly. I was probably very arrogant, thought I knew more than I did. And our expectation every week was you had to schedule 12 new appointments with prospects for the next week. You had to do that. And it was Thursday night. I had probably $20 to my name. I was in my office And all of my coworkers who were my age, a lot of them, 8 or 9 of us that hung out and chummed out around a lot, they had their 12 appointments scheduled for next week. I didn't. I was at number 10. And it's maybe 6 o'clock on Thursday. Thursday nights were party night, go to the bar. We were all single. And they came knocking at my door and said, all right, let's go. I said, I only have 10 appointments, you know. I can't leave yet. And they're like, oh, well, that's a bummer. We're going to the so-and-so club. We're going to have a good time. And they left. Or at least they walked out, you know, commenced to getting their coats and boots on. And I sat there in my office and I thought, let's see here. Do I really want to bother people on a Thursday night by cold calling them out of the phone book? Is that really what I want to do tonight? You know, I could probably call them within an hour, have my last two scheduled, but you know what? I'm going to give people in the area the night off. I'm not going to bother them. I'll come in tomorrow, refresh. I'll schedule my 2 appointments in the morning. I'll be done for the week. So I had to think about this. Do I think about drinking the beer with my buddies at the pub, or do I pick up that phone? Beer or phone. And that went out of my head for probably all of about 3 seconds. I think you know my choice. I chose the beer at the pub. And I'll never forget going to the ATM on the way there and just hoping I had $20. It was like the slot machine in Vegas. You know, you put your ATM card in there and you punch the numbers and you just sit there and, you know, you're like, come on, come on, come on, come on. Hey, I got $20. I can spend the night with my buddies now. So that's what I did. And I got in the next day. I called almost all day. I scheduled 1 appointment because nobody's available on Fridays to answer their phone back then. And I had to come in Saturday morning to schedule my last one. So, very clearly, I chose the pain of regret rather than the pain of hard work. And 28 years later, that still sticks with me. 28 years, and that lesson still sticks with me. You might hear a little dog in the background. My little pooch, Chloe, is standing guard outside the door here. So, if you hear a little bark, she's harmless. So I want to think of what yours are. What are your pain choices? What are the things that you're deciding on right now that you can't quite determine? Should I go for it? Should I not go for it? If it's worthy, go for it. Because those are your brick walls. You know, the one thing that we oftentimes do in our species does it, and we do it on a consistent basis, is when we're looking at doing something new, we only see the negative in it. We only see the hard work of getting up early, asking for the raise, talking something through with your spouse, confronting someone who has disrespected you, or confronting conflict. Because that's our brains, man. Our brains are designed for that. They're designed to avoid everything that could cause discomfort. Our amygdala in our brain is very primal. It is what has kept our species alive. It's what got us to thrive as a species. And it's designed to do 2 things. Be lazy and be scared. Don't try anything new. Don't go through that brick wall. Don't confront that person. Stay safe. Stay safe. Stay safe. So that amygdala is always on alert in our brain. But we don't have the dangers that we had 1,000 years ago, or even 200 years ago. We don't often run into saber-toothed cats or dire wolves, or we're not really too concerned about lightning strikes like we used to be, or running out of food or water. But our amygdalas don't know that. It still thinks it's got a full-time job. And here's where that hurts us. Is there was a University of California, Berkeley study that came out recently that has validated all the other studies I've seen over the years. And that is this. You as a human being walk around throughout the day and you notice some positive things. A smile from a stranger. The touch of your loved one on the small of your back as you're standing in line somewhere. The smell of the bakery as you walk by it. You notice these positive things throughout the day. They're inevitable. But because our amygdalas are so strong, that part of our brain is still so wired for survival, for every one positive thing that you notice, whether it's a gesture, a thought, a feeling, a word you hear, an action of someone else, or something that you do, for every one positive that you notice 9 negative things. 9 to 1. I don't want to take those odds in my life. I do not want to consistently be looking for negative, negative, negative. Because negative things that we notice, negative energy, is like putting bad gas in your vehicle. It's not good for it. It destroys our creativity, our production, our confidence, our strength, our competence, everything. Where positive energy is putting premium gas in your engine. It builds us in all areas of life. So we have to find a way to turn our minds around and go 9 to 1 positive to negative. So I'm going to give you an exercise. And it's an exercise I have avoided for years because I thought this is cheesy, it's cliche, it's just not at all something I would normally have done. And I was really reticent to start recommending this to clients a few months ago. But I started doing it back in November, November 11th to be exact. And that is this. Have a gratitude journal. You've probably heard it before. And it's real simple. Train your brain to see the positive. Because you know what? There are 1,000 more positive things out there than there are negative. Now, CNN, MSNBC, Fox, CBS, ABC, and they don't want you to know that because they know what sells, scare and sex. Those two things sell. That's why everything we see on media, on the media, is scary. It's not reality. It's a small smidgen of reality. It's an ounce of truth covered with a pound of lies, but they know it sells. So we're going to flip that around. We're going to get you to start noticing the better things in life. So here's what you do. Get a journal. It can be a pad of paper. And every morning or every night, sit down for 90 seconds. And at that moment, write 3 things that you are grateful for. Just 3 things that at that moment you're grateful for. Make it specific. Make it small if you want. It can be, I'm grateful for my cold hands wrapped around this warm cup of coffee. It can be, I'm grateful for the fact that my dog came down and it put his head on my lap. I'm grateful for the great dinner we had last night and we all sat around talking and laughing. 3 things that are specific that you are grateful for at that one moment. Not something you were grateful for yesterday or last week or you might be grateful for tomorrow, but at that exact moment. And I'm gonna warn you, don't say things like, I'm grateful for my family and I'm grateful for my health. Well, of course you are. Those are given. And you've just used 2 of your grateful, I call them my G3s. You've just used 2 of your G3s right there. But if family is it, be specific. I'm extremely grateful for that Dawson and I were able to watch Ant-Man last night and discuss some of the Marvel movies we've seen over the years. Okay. Or I'm very grateful for the fact that I'm finally over bronchitis and I can take those deep breaths again. It sounds a little cheesy. And it is. But it works. It's neuroplasticity. You are changing your brain. You are training and changing your brain. You are training it to see the things that are reality out there and not just the negative. It takes 12 to 14 days of doing this, 4 to 5 times a week do it. It'll take you 12 to 14 days before your brain will begin to chemically and physically change. And soon enough, you'll be seeing a lot more positive than you see negative. You're going to be fueling your engine with a lot more premium and a lot less bad gas. That's how you overcome brick walls. That's how you choose your pain in this world. The right pain is to overcome the fears that are associated with it. You know, you think about when you were a kid, when you were a little child, up maybe 5 years old, 4 years old, you were indestructible. You feared nothing. There was nothing you couldn't do. There was no limit set on you until your family, your friends, your teachers, what you saw on TV, what you read in books, what you went to the movies and saw. they started changing you and putting limits on you. So I'm going to give you one more exercise today, and we're going to begin to wrap it up with a quick story. If you want to choose the proper pain, the pain of hard work and grit and blood, sweat, and tears, so that you can avoid that pain of regret that's eternal, if you really want to smash through those brick walls that are in front of you, go find a picture of you when you were 4 or 5 years old. Pull a picture out. Look into the eyes of that little boy or girl. Think about what that little boy or girl had planned for his or her future. Separate yourself from that little boy or girl. It's not you anymore. It's a separate child, a child that you love dearly, more than anything in this world. You love that little child. Notice the aspirations and the hope and the dreams and the confidence and the courage that that little child has. Then ask yourself, have I lived up to that? Would that little 4-year-old boy be proud of the man I am today? Is that little 3-year-old girl extremely ecstatic and happy of the woman I have grown into today? If the answer is no, I would bet everything I have it's because at one point or another, or multiple times, you have chosen the pain of regret over the pain of hard work. That at points that are crucial in life, you have chosen to walk away from the brick walls rather than smash through them. John F. Kennedy, while he was looking for funding for the space program back in the 60s, always told a story that I cherish. I love it. And I've shared it on air before. But he talked about these two Irish boys who'd run through the hillside in Ireland, poor, impoverished boys, two of them, that would run through the hillside every day, frolicking, you know, chasing frogs, butterflies, you know, fishing in the creek. And one boy had a little derby that his grandpa had given him. It was the only thing he owned. He didn't even own any shoes, but he had that derby, man. And he loved that derby. His most prized possession. But every day these boys would run, and they'd run further and further from their village. And then one day they came across this massive brick and stone wall, miles wide and, you know, 80 feet tall, let's say. They knew intuitively and instinctively that there was something phenomenal on the other side of that wall. It was their destiny. It was where they were designed to live and roam. But every day they would kick the ground, put their head down, and walk home with disappointment and a little bit of disgust. They continued to this day after day after day. And finally, the boy that had the prize derby got to that brick wall with his little buddy. And he might have been Randy Pausch's great-great-great-grandfather, I don't know. But one day he finally said, I've had enough. And he tore his derby, his prize derby, off of his head, and he flung it over the wall. And he looked down at his little partner. He said, hell, I don't have a choice now. I must scale the wall. What are your brick walls? What are they? Where are they? And when do they appear? Tomorrow is not your day to throw your hat over. Today is. Right now. Because every second we avoid those brick walls, every minute that we stay on this side and choose the pain, the wrong kind of pain, that pain of regret gets stronger and stronger, and we get weaker and weaker. Every second we stay on the wrong side of the wall, we begin to die a little more and a little more. So today is February 14th, 2022. February 15th is not your day. Today is your day. Throw your hat over the wall and scale it. Because Mr. Pausch said, the brick walls are there for us to show how badly we want something. Go out there and get it today. Thank all of you. I appreciate every one of you listeners as we grow each week. We're going to get better. We'll get better next week than we were this week, and we'll continue to do so and grow and grow. For all of you thrivers, strivers, and all of you survivors out there, man, I appreciate you. God bless you. God bless your families. God bless your friends, and God bless your dreams. Take care and make this week count.